Good evening and welcome to the O2 in London, England,
where the Salvation Army is celebrating 150 years of God's faithfulness with an international
Good evening and welcome to the O2 in London, England,
where the Salvation Army is celebrating 150 years of God's faithfulness with an international congress called Boundless, the whole world redeeming.
Wherever you're watching us from, anywhere in the world, welcome to the Boundless Live Pre-Show. And a very good evening and welcome to Boundless, the International Congress.
How exciting to be here. We're thrilled that you're with us.
And how hot has it been today in London, England?
It's killer hot out there. We've been praying for 150 years, Lord, send the fire. And it's like he answered us this morning.
The hottest day in a century we have just had in London. It has been almost 100 degrees today.
Absolutely.
But the atmosphere, as you can see behind me, there's people arriving, the Salvations. The atmosphere is electric. That's the only way I can describe it.
It is.
People can't wait to start this first session.
Yeah, not only, I mean, this is such an incredible thing, 150-year anniversary, the birthday of the Salvation Army, but also 126 countries of the world. This is kind of unprecedented, really, as we celebrate this together, because not only can people come and celebrate here, how many people are here celebrating? 15,000?
Yeah, 15,000 to 18,000 people are going to be on site.
That are present on site. But this is the first time in history where actually globally anyone with an internet connection can come be part of this celebration. This is literally a global celebration.
And what we said is that 98% of people, which is Salvationists around the world, obviously can't come to Congress.
That's right.
But through the wonders of this technology, you're one of those 98% and you're tuning in. So we thank you for tuning in. We ask you to stay with us. We ask you not to go anywhere. We're doing a full hour's pre-show leading you up to the session. 1 hour. And we have got a lot of interesting guests. We've got some social media stuff going on. We've got competitions. We've got prizes.
Yeah, I mean, we've tried to design this thing so that if you couldn't afford the airfare or just couldn't afford the time to come to this event live, you can actually get the best content possible. I mean, this is like, get your popcorn, get your cup of coffee, whatever, and sit down and stay with us because we're going to have some incredible interviews. We're interviewing Commissioner Jolene Hodder and Kenneth Hodder from West Kenya. Now, I've heard a rumor that West Kenya is the largest territory in the Salvation Army world.
I've heard that. We should ask them that when they come on to see whether that's true, because I've heard that as well.
So we can get some juicy details from some of the hottest Salvation Army stuff going on globally.
And I also hear that we've got the Saul Boys Percussion Group. I actually saw them arrive at the studio just before. They brought the drums in, so that's going to be a fun piece. I'm looking forward to seeing them. And they're performing, I think it's this evening or tomorrow. So it'd be great to see those guys, young guys, and they've got some amazing rhythms going on.
And Major Ray and Carolyn Begley, they have actually designed the first session of this Congress. They've actually done the whole thing, the planning of it. And this is a joyful army. That's the theme. Mm-hmm. Now, I understand the themes of each of the main meetings, Gavin. They are from a vision, a dream.
It is.
Is that right?
So the general came up with this, with his dream. So it's right. I dream. So they take all seven sessions, go with one of his dreams. And today being, I dream of a joyful army.
Yeah.
So this evening session will be that, and of course we're reflecting and building on that excitement.
How exciting. This is the opening session of the 2015 International Congress, and it's a time to commemorate the joyful way the Salvation Army has done this thing in the past, but also in the present, as also in the future. We believe that this thing, you know, the thing that brings us great joy, it would seem, in a joyful army, is this idea that what we're out to accomplish, which is to win the world for Jesus, is possible.
Absolutely.
It's possible.
And we need to make sure that this isn't just a huge celebration of what has gone on in the past, but we're looking for ways that we can pioneer the Salvation Army into the future.
Absolutely.
And that's come through really strongly in everybody that we've spoken to.
Absolutely.
So I am really excited. I can't wait to get just this first session, into the first session, get everybody in the arena, get all those Salvationists there, and get them pumped up and excited. And we've got the very people who have planned that, and they'd be able to tell us, I guess, the inside scoop.
Absolutely. And who gets the inside scoop? I mean, this is
these
exciting.
People at home, you get the front seats.
Absolutely.
You have reserved seats to watch this.
That's right.
So that's good. And also the people, as we say, who are arriving behind us. So please stay with us. We've got this full 1 hour show. It goes live inside the arena, actually, for the first half an hour. I'm not sure whether you knew that. Half an hour before, it goes on the huge arena screen, so everybody inside will be able to see this as well.
Yes, and then we stream the entire meeting as well, so that you'll stick with us and you'll be able to do that. And then after the meeting's finished, we do what every Salvationist loves to do in the world. Talk about the meeting.
Go to Starbucks.
That's
and
right.
Talk about the meeting and say what we liked and what
Absolutely.
We didn't like. And we're doing that, so stay with us.
Yeah.
Anyway, yesterday we had a lot of fun. Me and Danielle went walking around speaking to the delegates as they registered. And we spoke to some great people.
Absolutely.
And we had a camera with us. So take a look at this, guys.
Welcome, my name is Gavin.
My name is Pauline.
Pauline, pleased to meet you. So are you just registering?
Yes, I'm from Antigua.
Antigua? Oh, you must be from the coolest place.
Where are you guys from?
Hong Kong.
Hong Kong?
Yeah.
Wow, that's fantastic. Where are you guys from in New Zealand?
North, Whanganui, right at the top.
Hong Kong.
Whereabouts are you from?
Argentina.
Irona, from Zimbabwe. I feel temple call.
Now, what country are you from? Where are you both from?
We're both from Denmark.
Okay.
And then I'm from the Caribbean as well.
Okay. Tell me what your names are and where you're from.
I'm Sarah. I'm from the Philippines.
Philippines. LJ, from the Philippines as well.
Sherry, from the Philippines as well.
Now, is this your first time in London?
Oh, no, we live here.
You live here. So fabulous. So you volunteers?
Yeah, volunteers.
So you're from Norway, okay?
Yes.
So how long have you been involved with the Salvation Army?
Oh, many, many years.
Okay.
I'm more than 50 years now.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm an old lady.
What part of Norway are you from?
I am from the west coast of Norway.
Right. How long have you been involved with the Salvation Army?
My whole life.
So, and they're both Salvationists?
I'm yes.
Yes.
Sir.
How long have you been in the Salvation Army?
46 years.
46 years.
Wow, that's amazing.
So we're obviously super excited for Congress, like everybody is. Is there one thing in particular that you're looking forward to?
The praise and worship.
What are you most looking forward to about the Congress?
I think the blessing that will come from all of us being together.
What are you most looking forward to about Congress?
I'm looking forward to the sessions, and I'm looking forward to getting together with Salvationists from around the world and just seeing what a great army we have.
Now, is this the first time that you've been to anything like this?
Yeah, third time.
What are you most looking forward to about the Boundless Congress?
Well, just meeting a lot of people, fellow Salvationists from other countries, other languages. Yeah, and just connecting with people that also recognize that people from all different countries serve the same God.
Talk to me a little bit about what you're doing with the Salvation Army.
My work is in Italy for the Italy and Greece Command. I am the anti-human trafficking coordinator. And project ministry, we've started new ministries in Italy, and we're pushing boundaries.
Hello, well, good morning, my name's Gavin. Pleased to meet you, Pauline.
Pauline, it is, Pauline. Yes.
Whereabouts are you from, Pauline?
Guildford.
Okay, and I'm looking, and I'm going to guess that you're a volunteer this week.
I'm a volunteer, as I've got it.
So, what made you want to step forward and volunteer, Pauline?
Why not volunteer for such a great occasion? The Lord has done so much in the army in 150 years, but we've got a lot more to do.
It's amazing. Did we speak to some great people? I could have spoke to them people literally
Fantastic.
All day.
Yeah.
That's what the Congress is all about, those people that were registering, the excitement that they felt, and some of those stories that they were sharing then.
Pretty exciting people
great.
From all around the world.
All around the
Incredible.
World. Incredible. Now, our very first guest, and these guests are in charge of planning the entire session. It's my pleasure to introduce good friends, Majors Begley, Ray and Caroline, thank you so much for coming in,
guys. Thank you. We're delighted to be here.
So, the first question is, tell me about this session that you've planned for today.
Session 5 is based on Matthew 28, going into all the world and preach the gospel. So it's a multicultural celebration, and we wanted to show the army world just how incredible our army is, culturally, in theatre, dance, drama, music. And so we're putting on a real spectacular, and it's taken 18 months of hard work.
Okay.
Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
So
now we just actually were saying that the joy, I think one of the great joys of the Salvation Army is this international kind of flavor. Tell us a little bit about, like, how did you decide which to pick, and how did you, like, how did all that happen?
Well, that was really quite complex, because we had to submit, didn't we? We had to submit the names of the sessions we wanted.
Yes.
And we submitted a whole list, and only one they said no to, and all the others we got. So we have Melbourne Stuff Band, Kenya West Vocal and Dance Group,
fantastic.
Korean Hawaii, fan dancers, yes. Hawaiian hula dancers.
Yeah. Wonderful, wow.
And then we were asked to coordinate a mass timber brigade of 200 ladies and 3 men.
Okay.
Great.
Yes.
Great.
Hooray for that.
Gender equality, finally.
Exactly.
Timbers, right?
And the 3 men come from Australia.
Really?
Wow. 3 timberlists, men from Australia.
I think
you're going to
say Africa.
So, yeah. No, no. And we're dealing with 27 different territories around the world. So that in itself, the complexity of answering emails at 11 o'clock at night or 6 o'clock in the morning.
So your 27 territories around the world are participating in this
one event.
Yes. Event.
We have 600 in the cast in one event.
Wow.
So that gives you an idea of...
Tell me, Ray, how did you get all those timbers together to practice, or haven't they practiced? How did you do that?
It's all been on the internet, so on YouTube,
okay.
So that hopefully we'll all come knowing the routine. That's the idea.
Yes.
We've said to them regularly, you know, practice, do this, get it ready. Right. And then on Friday, they'll meet together for the first time.
Wow.
And the Waverley Temple Timbrels leader, Megan Lukes, is in charge of that. She's written the different beats. And she will work that through with them.
So it's something else that's all been done online.
Yeah.
So
online,
from all countries, they've all gone and learnt all the beats.
And then the general decided that he wanted the timbrelists on the March of Witness as well. So behind all 7 bands, we have now 30 timbrelists. So we've had to create 7 timbrel brigades.
Yes.
So it's...
there
is joy in the Salvation Army.
Yeah. It's not like this is all that you've been doing, because you guys actually have full-time vocational...
We have a large corps called Boscombe on the south coast of England.
Right.
And so we've kept going all the way through.
Tell us about your ministry at Boscombe. What's going on there?
It's a really exciting big corps. It's a very traditional corps in many ways, but very much in the community. So we have homeless projects, and which run all the time. So it's everything the army should be in one corps.
Wow.
So it's fantastic.
So we literally run from Monday morning to Sunday night.
Right.
And we start again on Monday morning.
And in our spare time, we prepare a Congress meeting.
And Congress from all over the world.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Oh, it's
you could be watching Netflix, but instead, you're joyfully celebrating the International Army.
Yeah.
What
we've
a great
loved
thing.
It. We've loved being hooked right into the whole Congress.
And,
and it's been humbling just seeing people from around the world and the way they work and what they do
in the name really
of Christ.
People really prepared. Really, humbly prepared for this event.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, we've got to admire that and salute some of the sacrifices that have been made to come.
Absolutely. And talk to me about your best possible outcome of tonight's meeting. Like, what are you dreaming about? Like, if all, you know, I know it's probably been an absolute mountain of detail and paperwork and all that kind of stuff, but like, if you could just dream about tonight.
We've been told that from the moment we start to the moment we finish, we must be spot on time.
Yes.
My fear is running over.
Right.
So that's it, really.
I think for me, it's just to encourage people and just to show how great the Salvation Army is and how we can worship and celebrate.
And to proclaim the name of Jesus.
In our own style.
Yes.
Yeah.
So have you ever said on a personal level, is there one highlight in particular that you're looking forward to in this Congress?
Finishing our session.
Saturday morning,
it's waking up. Thank God. Exactly.
Now, you're no stranger to professional entertainment.
No, I trained as a dancer with the Australian Ballet.
Right.
Worked for Disney in America.
Right.
In Hollywood.
Right.
With Mickey and Minnie.
Hey.
And then I came to London.
Yeah.
And I did 7 West End shows. And while I was in Evita, the principal dancer in Evita, God really called me to become an officer.
Wow. Yeah.
So I left the stage and went into the training college. And within weeks, the Salvation Army commissioned a 10-part series, television series, called Marching Us to War,
right,
which I was pulled out of the training college as a cadet to choreograph, so I gave it all up for the Lord, and then I was back in the dance studio.
Well, isn't that the way the Lord works?
Exactly.
He uses our gifts and our passions and our skills.
All these years later,
kingdom.
I've been able to, I speak the language of production, lighting,
yeah,
sound, and so on. So it's been great.
What a wonderful thing you've offered, and thanks for doing it.
Pleasure.
Putting all
pleasure.
This time and effort and spare energy, and we're so excited.
And we're excited for the session, absolutely. Yeah. I can't wait to see him.
Yeah.
Okay, we.
We're also excited that you've joined us. We're thrilled that you're here. Stay tuned for more, and we're going to be right back after these few minutes.
Social media hub here at Boundless 2015. We're monitoring all the conversations happening around the world. I'm Phil Cook, this is JB Atkins, and we're hearing some interesting stuff. You know, it's only the start of the conference, but we're hearing some remarkable things of people who are excited, motivated, thrilled to be here. What are you hearing out there?
It's crazy. We're getting tweets from everywhere, Phil, from New Zealand, from
oh, wow.
Fiji, from right here in the UK. I just had Kane from Wales. He said, today's going to be a good day, hashtag
yeah.
Boundless 2015. I'm meeting so many amazing people, man. How about yourself?
Well, you know what? I saw a tweet from Christina Tyson, who's the editor of The War Cry. She's already here.
Amazing.
And it's funny, I got one from Rebecca Howen, who said she'd only been here 5 minutes, and she's already bought the new songbook.
Oh.
So people are pretty excited. They're hitting the bookstore. Amazing. They're hitting the exhibits. It's a pretty remarkable time. So here's the question. What's the hashtag we should use? What's the Twitter handles? Talk
sure,
to us.
Sure. Yeah, so the hashtag for the event is hashtag Boundless 2015. So we want you guys to, first of all, follow us on Twitter,
yep.
twitter.com/SavingTV, Instagram as well. If you guys
never
have pictures
aspired.
From the Congress, if
yeah,
you guys are out watching live right now, send in pictures, repost pictures, tweet. We love your interaction. And the Instagram is also instagram.com/SavingTV. We actually just got a tweet in from Katie, which is at TopCat87. She said, so much fun. This city doesn't sleep. It might doze or slip into a quick nap. But it does not sleep. Hashtag Boundless 2015.
That's London.
So,
that's London.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Well, let me tell you, stay tuned because we've got a film festival coming up. If you're here in London, there's the Boundless Film Festival that's coming up starting tomorrow. Also, we're going to start having some trivia competition here
yes.
online. If you're a trivia expert about this, the Salvation Army, Danielle, Gavin, they're going to throw out some interesting questions for you. And you want to be ready to tweet those back to us at SAVNTV, both on Instagram and Twitter would be fantastic. So remember, we're the social media hub. We're going to be here the whole time, and we want to hear from you to find out what's going on in your experience at Boundless 2015. Back to you guys.
Oh, welcome back. Great. That social media hub is just the best. Guy, you're rocking it over there. You're doing really good. Let's keep it up. Please get in touch with us. This show is about how we communicate, and we want you to really communicate with us. And talking of communication, last night we had the most amazing musical highlighted festival to really kickstart this whole Congress. The International Staff Band took a huge role in this, as well as the Pasadena Songsters, the Angola Band. We had a huge timbrel brigade that
yes.
took part. It was a very, very traditional Salvation Army celebration that really got everything kicked off.
Yeah.
We had cameras there to see that, and we also put some interviews in there with the International Staff Band Master and some of the assistants, so let's take a look.
I never aspired to be the territorial
right.
music director, but I happened to be in the right place at the right time, so they have been just the most wonderful 20 years to be the conductor of the ISB.
So looking to the future, how do you see the staff band evolving in any way?
Well, hopefully the staff band will be here for a long, long time to come. And we have many young players coming up in the territory. Hopefully some of them will find their way to find the service within the Salvation Army and the staff band.
Tell me, how old are you?
I'm 20 years old.
20, so have you literally just joined the band? How long have you been in?
Well, relatively. A year and a half I've done now, so...
Okay. How do your friends feel? I mean, not army friends, I mean friends who you're at college with. when you tell them what you're involved with? What do they think of it?
Obviously, it's harder to explain the kind of whole bigger army picture of it, but it's a great opportunity to explain, you know, what I'm doing with this band and why I make the effort to take the train every Wednesday to get down here. And it's actually a very easy witness for me to say, you know, I play with this brass band and it's all about God. You know?
Sure. That's
we have young people who are very, very extrovert about their faith.
Right.
And they bring their friends to the Salvation Army. They have no embarrassment about doing that. And I think that's something we should really encourage and really get them to keep doing.
Sure. So how important is music as an act of worship for you and as part of your faith?
Well, it's incredibly important, really. It marks our worship at the Salvation Army. I think God can speak through presentation that we give, through music in the army, through songs brigades and bands, and it's my passion as well. It's something that really can be an offering and bring people nearer to God.
Sure.
For me, on a personal level, it's really, really rewarding. Playing is kind of my best way to kind of connect with God on a personal level, and I really enjoy kind of, you know, giving my talents back to him through playing, so it's a huge privilege and really rewarding.
I think the staff band is still a special place to be and a special group to be part of. I still think, and we believe, it has a special role to still play in Salvation Army music, in terms of the music we play, in being a role model to other bands and musicians in this territory and beyond.
There's a lot of talk in the church and within the Salvation Army about what we sing and what we play and the relevance of music, and those discussions are valid. But clearly in the Salvation Army we have a remarkable heritage of music, and I think it's important that we don't lose sight of this wonderful input of music that is available to us, some of which stands the test of time.
Gosh, that was an amazing festival last night.
Yeah,
I think one of the highlights of what I'm hearing about from people that went was the Angola band, and I heard that there was actually standing ovations in there.
That's right.
That too. And also one of the solos in particular, Shal Henry John, who I think is at the Pasadena Tabernacle Corps, apparently just killed this song, "Oh Boundless Salvation."
Knocked it out of the park.
I think James Allen's new arrangement was just phenomenal.
That's a nice song to pick. Oh. For an international congress, "Oh Boundless Salvation," the founder's song. Is there a better song for that moment?
And I'm sure we'll hear that numerous times with arrangements.
I'm hoping.
Over the time. Anyway, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our next two guests today. I feel like they're good friends that I'm introducing as well. Commissioner Kenneth and Jolene Hodder. Welcome, guys.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here.
Firstly, you look so smart in the white uniforms.
Well, thank you very much. This is the uniform that we wear in Kenya for special occasions, and this is indeed a special occasion.
Nice. So your current appointment is what? Tell us about that.
We are the territorial leaders in the Kenya West Territory, which was created 7 years ago because the army was growing so rapidly in the country of Kenya, it was necessary to break it down into two territories from what had previously been one.
That's a great problem to have.
It's a terrific problem.
We're a baby territory, but we are growing leaps and bounds.
Right. Fantastic. So talk to us about, we've heard that Africa and Kenya is one of the strongest parts of the Salvation Army world.
Yes.
Talk to us about that.
Well, Kenya West is the largest territory in the Salvation Army world. We have about 125,000 senior soldiers and an equivalent number of junior soldiers. And at the present time, we're growing at the rate of about one corps per week.
Wow.
One a week.
That's just what we approve. You can imagine we have many more
that's
requests.
That's what you can count.
That's what we can count, exactly, exactly.
That is amazing.
And for us, a corps is defined as about 200 soldiers that can buy their own building, buy their own land, pay their own officer. In other words, they're self-sufficient from the beginning.
Right.
But the Lord is just moving in a wonderful way in Kenya West, and we just thank him for it.
Yeah, absolutely. Can you tell me what you think the secret is? I mean, for all of those of us listening from Western countries that are struggling to kind of get people to the to the meetings and involved in the Salvation Army, what are the secrets of your success?
Well, you know, the Lord and the Holy Spirit work in many different ways, as you know, but I think the two ways that really stand out in our territory are, first, in terms of daily life. Daily life is not easy in Kenya West, so there is a tremendous reliance upon the Holy Spirit and upon the promises of God to to sustain people as they go through life. And as they rely on the Holy Spirit, they find that indeed God's promises are true. Mm-hmm. So as a result, that generates its own joy and it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Right.
It builds up a momentum. The other thing I think that makes a difference is that there's a constant awareness of the fact that our own individual salvation, as important as that is, must also be understood in the context of a community.
Wow.
Everything is approached in a community sense in Kenya. So when you talk about putting together a program, it's a community decision. When you talk about establishing a core, it's a community decision.
Right.
So there's tremendous strength from the very beginning in terms of the whole thought process.
Right.
And when someone goes to the altar, it's not an individual decision. It encompasses the whole community, and everybody gets excited because another one has come to the Lord. And that person, particularly if it's a man, has great respect around the community.
Wow. What do you think are the greatest challenges facing Kenya West right now? What are the areas where you're really believing God to break through?
Well, obviously, because we're a new territory, as my wife suggested, there are a lot of infrastructure challenges. We don't have a lot of the mechanisms. We don't have a lot of those buildings that most territories would have.
Right.
So fundraising, trying to bring together people to make those things possible. But our people, again, respond beautifully. We're building a new training college in Kenya West. And our people decided they didn't want anyone other than themselves to be responsible for the chapel.
Wow.
So they are raising all the money for the chapel themselves,
right.
And that will be the heart and soul of the training college, of course.
Even the junior soldiers, everyone is contributing to the chapel,
wonderful.
And that's really exciting.
Isn't it? That is exciting.
Talk to us about some of your previous appointments, because I know this one is new, and you've served extensively throughout the world. Talk to us briefly about some of those.
Well, we served at IHQ for a few years, and that was wonderful. I actually wish all officers in the Salvation Army world could serve at IHQ, because you learn what a vast army we have, and that a decision might seem black and white, but when you get all the cultures around a table, there are no black and white decisions in the Salvation Army.
And we've also served previously as coordinators of a Congress. You might remember the International Congress in London.
That's right.
Atlanta. In the year 2000.
Right.
So that was a lot of fun for us. We thoroughly enjoyed it. So it's a delight for us to come here and to see how Colonels Hobgood and Commissioner Cochran have really moved the Army forward for this Boundless Congress.
And is it kind of exciting to come to a Congress that you're not organizing?
Yes.
It's a different perspective.
Yeah,
it is indeed, and we're enjoying it very much. It's
going to
be great.
More relaxed and just soak up the atmosphere and be more involved in every session.
Our job is to pray and to encourage. That's our job at this conference.
How many from West Kenya were able to come?
We have about 60 delegates here from Western Kenya.
That's fantastic.
Which is very exciting and thrilling for them. They're having a wonderful time. One of our groups is going to be performing as a part of tonight's program.
Yes.
As you might know, Wateule, which means the chosen in Kiswahili.
Fantastic.
And they'll be performing throughout the week, so they're looking forward to it.
What one thing would you say you would be your prayer that those 60 delegates would take back to your territory?
That they're a part of an army world. You know, most of our people have never been out of their village. So for them to come here and to see that there's this bigger army world and that we're all connected in one way, I find that very exciting for them.
Yeah, that's right. They will.
And then on a personal level, what do you hope to take away from the Congress?
A renewed understanding of the privilege it is to serve. Because wherever you serve the Lord, you know it's as a result of His plan and as a result of His will. So to come together and to see how your part of the kingdom fits into all the others to create a beautiful whole is a very encouraging and a very inspiring thing. So that's what we'll take back with us.
It's fantastic.
Do you think we're as passionate commissioners we used to be? I mean, we walked around the museum yesterday and we saw some of these, and we'll talk about the skeleton army and all these things that happen. Are we as passionate and fired up as we used to be? Or are we sitting back on our morals and saying how good we are and we like our uniforms and...
Well, in Kenya West, I can say the passion is very much there. There is not a single worship session that takes place in Kenya West that isn't accompanied by dancing and singing and coming
it
to the altar. Tremendous passion.
Right.
The open air is alive and well in Kenya West. And even if our society were different, and even if there were different opportunities for evangelism, I still think the passion would be there. The passion for Christ, it seems to me, is a product of the strength of one's faith. And that comes along with it. You don't automatically generate it. You commit yourself to the Lord, and He rewards you with that passion for His kingdom.
That's wonderful.
And, you know, I think that passion, therefore, will occur anywhere in the world if we commit ourselves to Christ.
That's fantastic. And actually really hopeful for us because, you know, this has been described, this whole internet streaming, saving TV's mission
absolutely.
As sort of the street corner of this of this millennium, you know?
Absolutely
this
right.
This is actually how we do the open air now.
Sure.
So we're
absolutely
excited.
Right. And you're doing a terrific job.
Thank you. Well, we really appreciate the time that you've taken to come and speak to us today.
Sure
we thank you for your support because you support us massively. We really appreciate that.
And your service to the Army world.
Thank
you so
thank
much
you
for
very
all
much.
That you've contributed.
You. It's been great to be with you.
Thank you. Thank
God
you so
you.
Much. Guys, right. I hope you enjoyed that interview there. We're going to go straight over to our social media hub and find out, have you been connecting with us? Guys, what's going on?
Hey guys, welcome back to the Social Media Hub here at Boundless 2015. Here's an interesting post I just saw a second ago. Joanne Cochran in Australia just posted that she's setting her alarm for 3:30 a.m. so she can get up in Australia and watch us on boundlesslive.com. Now, that's the site where you can monitor the entire conference, boundlesslive.com. And if you're here in London, we'd encourage you to tweet it to your friends, put it on your Facebook page, send an email out to everybody you know, share with them that they can watch the conference just like they were here on boundlesslive.com. Boundlesslive.com is the key place where all this is happening. What other stuff are you seeing out there, JB,
There's
on social
so much
media?
Excitement in the Twitter sphere, Phil. It's crazy. Miss Fee just said she's never been so excited about anything in her life.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, and
that's
people are posting amazing stuff. I mean, Mark from Memphis, he just posted a video about his adventure last night in London, and I'm seeing Salvationists everywhere, man.
Well,
it's
the conference
crazy.
Is just starting, so we're getting posts from people touring around town.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're getting from all over the place, and they're very, very excited. What else are you hearing?
You know what? Ann Westmoreland, she just said she's ready for the day, #Boundless2015. By the way, guys, the hashtag for the event is #Boundless2015. Go ahead and follow us on Twitter, @SavinTV, on Instagram, @SavinTV. We love your participation. She just tweeted a beautiful picture of the O2 Arena.
That's fantastic. Well. Oh, the O2 is amazing. This is an amazing
spot.
And by the way, let me say, this whole event is sponsored by the Salvation Army Vision Network, SAVN.TV. Check it out. It's a great site, and it's really the digital street corner for the Salvation Army. So keep Twittering, keep posting, keep talking to us. We're here all the entire conference, and we'll send it back over to Gavin and Danielle.
We're so much fun. That's what we're having so much fun here together. Isn't
I don't think we're
great?
Allowed to have this much fun. I don't think this is right. I think we're supposed to be a little bit, I don't want this to work. This is going great. Again, thank you for joining us. If you've been watching us from inside the arena, I hope you've enjoyed what you've seen. I hope you've enjoyed our guests. We have way, way more to come online. But unfortunately, we're going to have to say bye to you guys in the arena. You've got some guests probably just underneath these screens where I'm speaking to you from. So enjoy. That means you're watching online, so thank you for sticking with us. We have got so much more coming up, so don't go anywhere. Boundlesslive.com is how you can get in touch with us, so please, please get in touch. As the guys on the social media hub said, we've still got some great guests. Sowell Boys Home Percussion Group, they're going to be coming up it's our next guest, so very soon, before this evening's session. So now a great little piece on something called One Army, which I'm sure you've heard about. Let's take a look.
What is one army?
Interesting.
Resource.
Bible studies.
So easy to pick up and use.
Lots to think about.
It is really for all ages. In so many languages.
Open to anybody.
One in our aim.
It's just really useful to me to share.
It's been quite good for us as a family.
There is a specific focus on our youth and our young people.
Suited for people with no army background and army background.
The answers to some questions.
It's really great.
The material will continue to grow.
It's simple, it's very helpful, it's not patronising.
I'd say the sky's the limit.
fabulous, isn't it, watching some of those things sometimes and seeing how we're striving for one army around the globe. What we intend to do every single day when we join us online is to look at a more unusual Salvation Army project that maybe you haven't seen. This is a TSA project. And today we're going to watch a great piece on Rwanda. I hope you enjoy.
Welcome to my country, the land of a thousand hills. Rwanda is a lost country of endless mountains and strongly serious, but the genocide left us broken and our people scattered to neighboring countries. In the last few years, we have been focused on rebuilding our country and educating our future generations. My name is Christy. I live in a village called Getoro in Rwanda that was built by the Salvation Army for the refugees that we are returning back to the country. In 2007, the Salvation Army built 70 houses here and we were given one to live in. We have a simple but happy life. My husband Mark is not well enough to work, so I grow corn, wheat, and bananas on the land that we were given by the Salvation Army. We also have a few chickens and a cow. Any food that is left over, we trade with our neighbors. The Salvation Army continues to support our village in many ways. When we first moved here, I needed to walk a long way to collect water every day, but now the Salvation Army has built a bore water pump, which is a great blessing to our community. In 2009, the Naigatari Preschool opened where my youngest son Cedric now attends. Many children in Rwanda had malnutrition and strong growth, so the preschool also served a meal of porridge every day. There is no primary school in the village, so my older children walk 8 miles along each day to the nearest school. We hope that one day the Salvation Army preschool will expand into a primary school and even a high school, so all our children can be educated nearby. There is a great community here in the Ghetto Village. We live together, pray together, and support each other in difficult times. My family has been so blessed by the Salvation Army over these years, and we are very happy here. We now have our own home, our children have a good education, and we can provide food for our family.
I love watching those clips and seeing all those young kids either in one of the schools and just seeing a Salvation Army project. Yeah, that we wouldn't normally get to see and seeing how it's very different, certainly from the Salvation Army that I'm used to seeing.
And again, that internationalism of the Salvation Army being such an incredible strength of our movement.
Sure. We love that. And talking about that whole international flair, it gives me enormous pleasure to introduce our next guest, the Soul Boys Home Percussion Band.
Yay,
I feel like I should clap and go, woo!
Yeah.
We're
excited.
Guys, welcome. I'm going to go around and ask you your names first, and then how old you are, okay? So let's start with you.
My name is Ta Hyun Che. I'm 17 years old.
17.
My name is Kwan Woo Cho. 17.
My name is Jeogum Kim, my 70.
Okay. Nice.
And your name, sir?
My name is Byung-yun Kim. I'm 52.
Oh, I didn't know you were going to say how old you were, and you did. Good for you. So, guys, you're going to be taking part in this session. They're going to be part of the one of the main sessions, and you've brought some of the equipment in with you today. If I could ask you first, how long has the group been formed?
Cool.
Okay. Yeah. This is composed of 2 years ago.
especially for the Boundless Congress.
Wonderful. Yeah.
Wonderful. Can you ask them if they're involved in a Salvation Army project back at home? Are they in a corps or are they in a youth center or something?
한국에서 그 구세원에 어떻게 활동하고 있지? 어디에서 활동하고 있죠?
중앙. Do you know if they're, are they involved in a corps or a Salvation Army project?
구세군 영문이나 시설에서 살고 있죠?
네, 저희 보육 시설에서.
Can you ask what the name of the corps is?
그 영문 이름이 actually they are working at the center.
Oh, they work at that center. Oh, fabulous. Okay, so they don't go to right. Good.
They live in Seoul Boys' Home.
Right. Okay, so they're not. So they don't go to one of the churches in particular. Good.
Yes.
So if you could tell us when they come to play their instruments, would they be able to have a little go with them now and show us how they're going to perform? Could you ask them if they could do that for us?
어떻게 소리가 나는지 한번 쳐줘봐 줄래?
Let's have a little look. Okay, do we need to? Okay, so can you show us a little bit of that one? Yes. Oh, holy cow, that's great. Cool. Okay, and who plays this one here? Who takes that one? Is that you? Whose is this one? You come round, you can play it. That's fine. You can come round, that's fine, don't worry. Scoot up on the chair, scoot up here. And then you can sit down and play. There you go. Let me hear you play it.
This is not proper.
This is not, that's okay. Play it with your hand, let's hear it.
Yeah.
There you go, just sit just right down there. Okay. Okay, that's cool.
Now these are traditional Seoul instruments. They're Korean instruments,
yes,
is that right?
That's right. These are Korean traditional
instrument.
Wonderful. Percussion instrument.
And what are they, can you tell us what they're called? The ones that you just played.
This is janggo, and that is gwenggwari.
Okay, wow, fantastic.
Don't repeat that back.
That is, and that actually has some power to it, doesn't it? When you were playing that, that was
loud.
That was loud.
Very loud, yes.
Yeah, this will be fantastic. And we love the uniforms, too, that you've created, the Salvation Army flavor.
That's right, yes.
And Korean traditional.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, this is fantastic. What
can
a wonderful.
Can you tell us something about the boys' home where these guys live? Would you be able to tell us that?
Okay. 서울 후생원에 대해서 잠깐 소개해 줄래요?
저희는 그 가정 환경이 가정 형편이 어려운 사람들 모여가지고 한 원장님, 아버지, 친구, 선생님, 동생들 합쳐서 총 100명에서 같이 살고 있습니다.
Yeah, in Seoul Boys' Home, around 100 families live together.
Wow.
As a manager is our father, and manager's wife is we call it our mother because we are orphans. So sure. We enjoy live in Seoul Boys' Home.
Okay. Could you ask this guy here if he enjoys living there?
서울 후생원에서 사는 게 행복하죠?
네.
Yeah, I'm very happy to live in Seoul Boys' Home.
That's wonderful.
Well, listen, guys, we really appreciate the fact that you've taken the time to come in.
Yeah, we're super happy that you've come here, too, actually. And we're glad that you're performing, and we're glad that you're part of the Salvation Army, and you're part of a very important part of the Salvation Army. One thing that Korea has offered the Salvation Army has been a real powerful prayer.
Yeah,
you guys are known for your prayer, and we believe that's a fuel that's helped the whole Salvation Army world. We're not only thrilled to have these guests, but we're also thrilled to have some visitors with a little message. If you like VeggieTales, tune into this and then come on right back.
A 100 years ago, this is what animated vegetables look like.
And yet 100 years ago, the Salvation Army had already been going strong for 50 years.
That makes them what? Like, help me out, Bob. I can't count that high.
150 years old, Larry.
That's a lot.
It sure is. Thank you, Salvation Army, for 150 years of sharing the gospel.
And meeting the needs of God's children everywhere.
Congratulations.
Can we go back to 3D now? 2D tickles.
Welcome back to the Social Media Hub here at Boundless 2015. I'm Phil Cook. This is JB Adkins, my buddy here, and we are monitoring global conversations happening on a number of social media platforms from around the world. I saw a post from David Holland just a little bit ago that said, "Today I'm incredibly proud to be a Salvationist." And that's what we're hearing from a lot of people. They're very excited because this is our start. This is our kickoff. And so some amazing, really some amazing people are thrilled to be here. What are you hearing out there, JB?
Well, I heard from Estelle Blake from Rome.
Yeah.
She said, hashtag Boundless2015, getting the party started with meeting friends and making new friends, praying for Precious and Blessed from South Africa. And I wonder if those are names of people If they're watching right now, that'd be incredible.
That'd be fantastic.
Precious and blessed. If you guys are watching, you know, feel free to tweet in. We want to hear from you guys, okay? Thank you so much for participating. Remember, the hashtag is Boundless2015 for the event. We're on Twitter and Instagram at SavinTV for both. If you have any questions, guys, we'd love to hear from you. Tweet into our guest. Make them, you know, tell them how much you appreciated them. Hashtag Boundless Live if you want to tweet in and be featured today. Also, we have a competition coming
up.
That's right.
Get your trivia on.
Yeah.
So tell us about it.
Excited. Yeah, so we're going to have Gavin. He's going to be shooting out some questions about the Salvation Army, such as when was the Salvation Army formed. And we want to hear from you guys. There'll be a prize involved. But if you guys want to win, you have to be following us at SavinTV, and you must use the hashtag Boundless Live. So remember to tweet that in. Your answers.
Boundless Live on your answers.
I'm looking forward to seeing
it. SAVNTV on Twitter, on Instagram. We want to hear from you. We need that conversation from you. We're gathering all these things. We're going to keep talking about it. And we want to hear your pictures.
Yes.
Send us your pictures. And when we get those, we're going to be posting them. Back to you guys, Gavin and Danielle.
Guys, thank you so much. Please get in touch with us. Listen to what those guys are saying. We really want to hear from you, and we want to hear those questions now and for the rest of the week. And just a heads up, we have the general coming in later in the week. So if you want to start getting those questions into us now, that would be a good idea. Now, a Salvationist who's really busy, a guy called Anthony Begonia from the Philippines. We've sent him out onto the street. I don't know whether this is a safe or a good idea, but we did to speak to the people around London, around the capital. And he got some really, really good feedback on what is the Salvation Army and what's it doing. Let's take a look and see where Anthony got to.
What is the Salvation Army?
I don't know.
What is the Salvation Army?
It's an army to salivate.
That's a great answer. What is the Salvation Army?
Salvation Army.
What is the Salvation Army?
What is the Salvation Army?
Service.
Just make up your best answer. What does the Salvation Army do?
They build an apartment.
I don't know what to say.
Stop slavery, I guess. That's always a good thing.
I don't want anything on the internet where I just look like I'm really dumb.
Who started the Salvation Army?
Prince Harry.
Chelsea.
He was a rebel from Cuba, I think.
Yuri Glassy.
Who founded the Salvation Army?
A man, I think. I don't think it's going to be a woman. I'll just go with John.
Good guess.
Phil Collins.
Abraham Lincoln.
Jagger John Booth started it.
When was the Salvation Army started and where was it started?
1942 in New York.
I don't know, but I would guess maybe World War I here in London.
100 plus years ago?
Maybe in the 90s?
I think maybe in the 50s.
I should know this.
1825.
In England here.
You know a lot. When was the Salvation Army started and where did it start?
I have absolutely no idea. And to me, being British, that's not a good thing to say.
Over the past few weeks, we've had over 16,000 Salvationists flooding the streets of London to help us out. What is the Salvation Army?
It's a charity that helps poor people.
To support less privileged.
Salvation Army is to help people who are helpless.
It's an organization helping people.
It is definitely an organization that reaches out to others in whatever forms, whether it be food, care, clothing, shelter.
They help a lot of people with alcohol problems.
Salvation Army is an army of mercy and hope for where sometimes there's only despair.
What is the Salvation Army?
Salvation Army is first and foremost a church that also speaks about the love of God through practical activities that we do within the community.
They raise money, they do stuff for veterans, and they get behind people, and that's really what the next generation needs to understand.
Who is this?
John Forsythe.
I guess we have a lot of work to do. Back to you, Gavin and Danielle.
You see, without some That's really fun. Interesting perspectives onto what people think the Salvation Army is.
Yes.
And what are we? And we need to learn from these people. We need to listen.
Yes, and what a great opportunity we have to spread the word this way.
Sure.
I mean, that's what we're doing, really, in this boundlesslive.com venture.
Sure.
It's fantastic.
Now, we said that we would have a great competition, and here's the very first one that we're going to be doing. And this is a chance for you to win this amazing prize. Look at this.
It's a bank.
This is a London. This is the official London mailbox. So if you're going to post your letters in the UK, the old snail mail, This is one of the things that you'll put in, obviously a bigger version, but you've got a chance to win this. But you can actually put money inside here. We were saying this would be a good collection.
Yeah, I think if you put money inside a Salvation Army official International Congress bank, it should belong to the Salvation Army. What do you think?
World Services appeal globally.
Get your bank, put your money in there, and let's support the International Salvation Army.
So, how do you win this amazing prize? We're going to set a question every day, and today's question is, it's not that easy.
No, it's you've got to be paying attention, but this is the question. Who was the third general of the Salvation Army? Who was the third general of the Salvation Army? And you need to answer that. How you win this incredible prize is you've got to send in a tweet using the hashtag Boundless Live.
So tweet us, hashtag Boundless Live. Very simple. Who was the third general of the Salvation Army? Do you know it? Have you got it down?
Oh, yeah, I know it, but I don't want to give it away. So, like, you know, you guys do your research, a little Google. It'll take you a minute. And then hashtag Boundless Live for this prize.
I can get the prize out to you. So make sure you get involved with that. Now, we have a film festival coming up towards the end of the week, the Boundless Film Festival. Some amazing submissions. And when I was looking through some of those submissions, one that just immediately jumped out as being so clever and taking so much time was something where they made the entire Congress out of Lego, literally Lego bricks. So we're going to take a little look now at that whole Lego thing. Hope you enjoy. So cool. You see what I mean?
That whole Lego thing is really clever. And creative.
But there's so much more of it, and you're going to get the chance to. We're going to give you the link later in the week as how you can watch the whole thing, because this thing runs 6 or 7 minutes.
Wow.
And runs for the entire Congress. So there's no point just talking about how clever it is. I think we should actually find the guy that is behind that.
Yeah, because that must be a genius.
And that genius is called Ashley, and he joins us now. Ba-da! Big reveal.
Hi, Ashley.
Ashley, congratulations. That is really, really good. And I have to say, the first question that we're going to ask you is, how long did it take you to put that together?
Well, it took around 4 months, kind of on and off. I started in the gap between Christmas and New Year.
Right.
And then kind of fitted it in up to the deadline at the early April.
Okay.
And talk to me about the inspiration for it, Ashley. Yeah. So just one day you were just like, I know what I'll do. What inspired you?
Well, I've got a little bit of history of making events in Lego. So when I saw the advert for the film festival, it kind of made sense to kind of put it together. And I did a smaller Lego video based on a Salvation Army band previously.
Yes.
But I wanted to do something on a grander scale, which kind of would show off everything.
What I loved about it and what we said when we watched it is you actually get characters in. Some of the characters I recognised. I know you're in UKI territory, that's not a territory that either of us in, but I still recognise even the likes of the TC here, Commissioner Adams, who's in there taking selfies. I recognise that one.
There might be some likenesses.
You're keeping quiet. We know some of those faces. We know that you knew who they were.
Now, you brought some Lego pieces with you here.
Yeah, we've got a little Gavin.
Right.
Oh, it's
little
us.
Gavin.
Oh, I see.
And little Danielle.
Oh, hey, look at that. That's nice.
So we've got our own little studio Lego set going here.
There you go.
Just a little bit.
So tell us about the core that you're from. I can see that you've got musicians' epaulets on. Where are you involved?
I'm from Cardiff Canton.
Okay.
In South Wales.
Right.
I'm a bandsman. I kind of play in a band first coming up.
So. How long have you been involved with the Salvation Army?
Since I was born.
Okay, so your parents are Salvation.
Yeah, I'm fifth generation. I've come through the YP and
Wow, that's amazing. What a great legacy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us about, did the Cardiff Canton do any outreach from the Corps in particular? Is there a charity shop or coffee lounge?
We got a charity shop across the road, which kind of make some money for the Corps. We do coffee mornings and we do open airs after the Sunday morning meeting.
Sure. So still involved in open air ministry. That's cool.
Yeah.
Every Sunday, the band goes outside.
Yeah, most Sundays after the meeting. Yeah.
Sure. So. And then any rest home, hospital visitation? Does the band do anything like that?
Yeah, it kind of mixes between going out in the street or just kind of going to hospitals and visiting. And,
right.
That's fantastic. So for your whole life, you've been doing this?
Well, yeah.
Yeah. What are you most excited about the Congress?
A lot of the concerts are exciting, but it's just coming together and kind of meeting all these different people.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
And seeing seeing the army across the world,
right.
how different it is, you know,
yes.
and kind of looking at those differences and kind of being inspired by how different people do things.
Celebrating that.
It's
well, listen, we appreciate
actually.
The fact that you've come
Thanks
in. Good luck
coming.
With the film festival.
Yes.
I know it's coming towards the end of the week. Thank
Thanks
you for making
for the Lego.
Us, I think, far better than what we look.
Absolutely.
And if we don't turn up one day, we're just going to put these two guys
That's right.
here.
That's right, absolutely.
And we don't need to say anything.
That'd be
Thank
fantastic.
You. Stay with us for a second, actually. Now, we've already introduced Anthony to you. Anthony's been out on the street speaking to people. Anthony's a really talented musician as well. And we asked him to do something with O Boundless Salvation, but with a different twist to it. So Anthony, as you see in this clip, starts to play O Boundless Salvation, but then he goes into a place called Covent Garden in London and asks random street entertainers to join in by playing this piece. And the outcome
times.
Is really, really good. Take a look, yeah. See what you think.
The Founder Song, O Boundless Salvation. Words that have touched generations that continue to inspire us even today.
Welcome back.
That
there's
was
something
that
beautiful.
Was clever, don't you think?
Well, I think there's something beautiful about asking people to join in our song, because that really is, O Boundless Salvation was written for the whole world to join in. I mean, this is a song that is singing for eternity, and everybody's welcome to sing it. And salvation, Jesus' salvation is for the whole world.
Yeah,
how exciting is that?
Even the street entertainers in Covent Garden.
Absolutely.
One army, hey?
One army, and we're leading up to a joyful army celebration. Yeah. It's actually about to begin. How
and
exciting.
Literally, within the next minute, we're going to be thrown into the inside arena, so you'll be able to
yes.
see everything that's going on. You won't miss anything. But what we do want to say is, when the main session finishes, if you can come back to us, that would be great. We're going to have a little post-show, 15, 20 minutes. It's a coffee time for us, isn't it?
Yeah, we've invited some friends over. Phil Wall's going to be here, and
up.
Valerie Mycroft's going to be here, and we're just going to have a chat with some
yeah.
friends about, just like you want to do after every Salvation Army meeting,
yeah.
you want to have a conversation about how God's impacted you and how that matters in your life.
Sure.
It's going to be exciting.
It will. So make sure you hang around after that session's finished. We would love to share with you some of their thoughts, really, and see what their idea were on the opening session, because it's an exciting day, session one.
Absolutely, a joyful army. You got to be part of it.
It says an awful lot. And then if you can't join us afterwards, make sure you come back tomorrow morning. We have a breakfast show tomorrow. More guests, more session planners, all coming into the studio to share what their inspiration is, to share what their love of God is, what their passion is, what their bit of this Salvation Army world is, and they're going to be coming in and talking about that.
We want you to have a front row seat.
We do, and you've got that. You've got it reserved.
Here
we've got
is.
Your back on that.
That's right.
So I've learned so much this morning.
Yeah, me
just
too.
Just from
it's
listening
been
to those guests mm-hmm. and seeing the diversity of the people. So enjoy the session. Come back to us afterwards if you can, and God bless.
I dream of a committed, effective, and joyful army, rooted and confident in the Word of God and on its knees. I dream of an army that truly reflects the mind of Jesus in its commitment to the poor and the marginalized. I dream of an army that practices what it preaches from the top leadership down, an army that is a visible and living example of kingdom values. I dream of an army that values its youth, where young people feel that they have a voice. I dream of an army with strong, relevant, and streamlined administrative structures and a more effective use of its financial and material resources. I dream of an army where all cultures are equally accepted and celebrated through the spiritual ties that bind us together. I dream of an army that shuns the culture of dependency. My challenge to you is to consider these dreams with proper reflection. Pause and think about what you need to change in order to make these dreams a reality in your own lives and in the world around you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please rise and greet our international leaders, General Andre Cox and Commissioner Sylvia Cox.
Please be seated. And I want to say how wonderful it is to be here, and thank you for that wonderful welcome. I want to wish each one of you a very warm welcome here to London and to this 9th International Congress in the history of the Salvation Army, where we will truly celebrate the boundless love, the boundless grace of God. I think we mean it, don't we? God has been so faithful to generations of Salvationists over these 150 years. He's faithful also to this generation of Salvationists. He will be faithful to those who will follow on long after us. It's a privilege and a pleasure for me to acknowledge in our midst this evening our distinguished retired international leaders of the Salvation Army. And I ask, will you please acknowledge their presence amongst us this evening? I hope that many of you will have the opportunity to meet with them as we gather here in these days. And here's just a little plug for the trade store. Don't forget to get your personally autographed copies of the 3 books that have been published in time for the Congress by Generals Rader, Larson, and Clifton. Well, we gather with a sense of excitement, for this is a great time of celebration, isn't it? We come to this place with thanksgiving in our hearts for what God has accomplished in and through the lives of ordinary, imperfect men and women, such as you and me. We come with excitement. Well, someone does down here. And we come with open hearts to listen to what God is saying to the Salvation Army in these days. We come with a sense of anticipation. We come with a sense of commitment as we wait in this place for a new manifestation of the presence, the power, and the anointing of God upon His people. He will send us back from these days to light a fire around the world as we do our part to fulfill the Great Commission. The world is needing us. Christ is leading us. Comrades, let us be true. His love sustaining us, prayer sustaining us, faith will carry us through. His service calling us, none appalling us, deeds of valor will do. For souls, my friends, are needing us. Christ is leading us. Comrades, we will be true. And if those words truly reflect our prayer and our commitment this evening, the desire of our hearts, then I believe that God is indeed going to bless us in these days with a mighty anointing of His Spirit. You're not here by chance. You haven't come just to sit in a chair and to be a spectator. It's important that each one of us come into this place with a willingness to open our hearts and to open our ears, to listen to what God is saying to us in these days. May we all be truly blessed as we celebrate God's boundless mercy and grace in these days.
O thou God of every nation, we now on thy blessing call. Words penned by William Pearson at a time when he envisioned the Salvation Army winning the world for Jesus, and it was still in the East End of London. The Salvation Army has traveled the world, winning it for Jesus. We're going to sing those words, led by the International Staff Band. I invite you to stand as we sing. Thank you very much, Bandmaster.
Thank you.
Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another,
Holy, 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 holy is the Lord Almighty. Whole earth is full of his glory.
At the sound of their voices, the doorpost and threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. For I am ruined. I live among a people of unclean lips, and I am a man of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the Lord, the King, the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken from the altar with tongues. And with it, he touched my mouth and said,
See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for.
Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying,
Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?
And I said, Here am I, send me. He said,
Go and tell this people, Isaiah. Go and tell.
He came to them and said,
"All authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always, even until the end of the age."
Of two people who by divine providence and inspiration were looking for ministry opportunities. In 1865, the Lord called William and Catherine Booth, opening their eyes to the great need of the masses around them in the East End of London. But that would be just the beginning. Never in their wildest dreams could they imagine what was in store for them. God was about to call to himself an army of salvation with men, women, and children getting saved, transformed by the blood of the Lamb, and empowered by the Holy Spirit to boldly go to all the world proclaiming the good news of the gospel, salvation for the whosoever. Nearly 150 years later, much has changed in the East End of London. The world has changed. But the call to worship and to preach the gospel to the whosoever and to care for the needy in all nations remains the same. Today, the Salvation Army is operating in over 126 countries. From the East End of London to the world, we are seeing before our own eyes the words so beautifully penned by John Goins coming into realization. They shall come from the east, they shall come from the west, and sit down in the kingdom of God, out of great tribulation to triumph and rest. They'll sit down in the kingdom of God, from every tribe and every race, all men as brothers shall embrace. They shall come from the east, they shall come from the west, and sit down in the kingdom of God. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome the representatives from all five Salvation Army zones.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please greet the representatives of the world for whom Jesus died? Will you please rise for the entrance of the Salvation Army flag as we sing the Founder's song, O Boundless Salvation.
Oh, Hello, my name is Melanie. I'm a soldier at Clapton Corps in London. Woo! In London Central Division. That's in the UK and Ireland Territory. Hi, everyone. I'm absolutely honoured to give you my testimony tonight. I first encountered the Salvation Army through the toddler group at Clapton Corps, which is in Hackney, East London. I was then a mother of a newborn baby and a toddler. I had just moved to the area. I had a nice house, a loving husband, nice friends, and a career, which on the surface seemed to be perfect. I had everything. But actually, I was finding motherhood stressful and rather lonely. I was very disillusioned by my job and realized I would never find happiness through a career. I'd been a Buddhist for 10 years previously, but that had not lived up to my expectations, leaving me feeling lonely as a person. Added to this, I was fearful for the world, which seemed to be suffering and on the road to destruction through human selfishness. Politics didn't seem to provide any answers, although the media and society seemed to be consumed by ever-changing policies. This left me feeling unhappy and depressed without any hope. What I had begun to deal with the stress and growing despair of my life, was to drink wine in the evenings. I began to chat to the young volunteers at the Corps about the Salvation Army, but it was the actions of the Corps officers that really did it for me. I had listened to policies and theories on economics, philosophy, but it never really seemed to change people for the better. But at Clapton Corps, whoever walked through the doors, or more likely sometimes whoever fell through the doors, whatever their life circumstances, they were welcomed, given time, love, and acceptance. How did they do it? What powered them? I had worked for charities for years where employees like myself became disillusioned, even with the best intentions and being caring, they became burnt out and even resentful of the people they were there to serve. I became interested in what it was that enabled my Corps officers to consistently offer hope, love, and acceptance without viewing people as a problem. I knew it wasn't a job description or politics or an academic theory that enabled them to be so kind and capable. So I met with my Corps officer, Ruth, and I started attending the Sunday service at the Corps. I was a bit embarrassed about this, to be honest, as I thought I had superior intelligence. And I told my husband and my friends that I was actually attending a toddler group that happened to be at the Salvation Army on a Sunday morning. At first, I thought they were pretty crazy, and I sat at the back. I wasn't really convinced about God or even Jesus. I realized, though, that I did need to put what I thought was rational, intelligent thinking aside and take a step of faith. I enjoyed the fellowship and the worship, and also being part of the outward-looking community that is at the heart of the Salvation Army Corps in Clapton. I have to tell you, the locality of this community was up until really recently known as the Murder Mile, and this was with very good reason. One morning, after feeling particularly desperate and down, I called my Corps officer, Ruth, while I was on the bus, and told her I was coming straight over to the Corps to give her Jesus a go. We prayed in the hall, sat on tiny little chairs, because it was actually set up for toddler group at the time. But that day, I gave my life to Jesus. Amen. And you know what? I gradually started moving towards the front of the church, got involved with Sunday school, and I became an adherent. Meanwhile, though, at home, my drinking was getting worse and worse. And before I had my children, I'd actually attended an abstinence-based program where I'd gained a year of sobriety. But I didn't have God with me then. And that was actually a requirement of this abstinence-based program, but of course I thought I knew better. But after growing in faith and getting honest with Ruth about my drinking, she advised me to go back. So I gave the abstinence-based program another go, and then but I had God this time, and what a difference. After a year's sobriety, I became a soldier. And for me, this was a turning point of my life. Thank you. Thank you. I began to change from the inside out, where the stuff outside became smaller, and I relied on Jesus. He filled me with his grace. I'm happy to tell you now, I am 4 years and 2 months sober. Thank you. But even better, I sit on the front row now of Clapton Car. Thank you for listening. I hope you have a wonderful Congress. Thank you.
Hallelujah. My name is Lieutenant Colonel Manikumari from Kenya East Territory. I am very happy to share my testimony. I was born and brought up in a Hindu family. I used to worship various idols, goddesses regularly with much reverence. I was used to worship each day one image of God. At a young age, I married John, who was a strong Salvationist. As I was preparing for my wedding, I was sworn in as a soldier at Yeluru Central Corps in Yeluru Division in India Central Territory in 1986. To be honest, at that time, I only became a senior soldier for the sake of the marriage. I was not fully convinced or converted, and my heart was far from the Lord Jesus. Still, God blessed me with a baby boy, but when my boy was 6 months old, he was affected with cholera disease. After 10 days of intensive treatment, the doctor lost his hope and said there was no chance of survival for him. In this tragic situation, all the family members were left feeling sad and hopeless. I pleaded with all my goddesses to save my son, but I received no answer. The commanding officer of my corps visited myself and my son and advised me to pray unto the Lord for healing and strength. I did not really even know how to pray, but I just poured out my heart at the feet of the Lord. I beseeched God and said, if you are living God, please give life back to my son, and I will surrender my life to you as full-time servant in your ministry. The Lord saw each tear that fell and knew my innermost desires. He saw my suffering, pain, and heard my humble cry. the all-powerful God, full of compassion and his unfailing love, healed my son. The doctors were amazed for that he survived and flourished. God turned my sorrow into joy. My testimony is that my son's sickness led me into salvation. Praise God. I experienced God's compassion and found hope in a hopeless situation. I accepted Jesus as my personal Savior and I surrendered my life fully to him. The glory of believing in Jesus and his mighty power transformed me from darkness into light. God chose me from an idol worshipper's family to become a Christian. As per my covenant with the Lord, my husband and I surrendered our lives to the ministry of Jesus Christ and entered into the training college as cadets in the year 1990 as followers of Jesus session. When I entered into the training college, I was a raw material with rough edges. The college was like a workshop for me, and I was nurtured in faith. The Lord who called me, melted me, molded me, filled me with his knowledge, and then anointed me with his Holy Spirit. God empowered me to learn new skills and do great things for his glory. My journey as an officer has been an exciting privilege. I fixed my goals on bringing change and conversion in my parents' family and prayed and waited for that miracle to happen. It was only a miracle that could bring them into the knowledge of God. I am highly favored by God. I offered my parents and my family into God's love. My faith looks up and is focused on God alone like an anchor. Jesus is a lover of souls. He saved my parents by his grace a few years after I started my ministry. They are now committed soldiers in the Salvation Army. One of my sisters is now serving as Home League Secretary, and another one is serving as a Salvation Army officer in a corps in India's Central Territory. My only brother's family still need to be saved and continue to worship idols, and this is one of my daily prayer subjects. I believe God has made me an instrument for saving souls, growing saints, and serving suffering humanity. I do this in humility and through his power. I heard his voice through the leadership to go for the missionary service in Africa zone. I and my husband obeyed his call, and by the grace of God, now we are serving in Kenya East Territory. And despite the challenges of living away from home, we continue to follow him faithfully. I'll follow thee, of life the giver. I'll follow thee, suffering redeemer. I'll follow thee, deny thee never. By thy grace, I'll follow thee. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Cadet Chris DeBorowitz, and it is an honor and a privilege to be here this evening. 3.5 years ago, I washed up on the front doors of the Salvation Army's Adult Rehabilitation Center in St. Petersburg, Florida, of the United States. I was court-ordered and suffering with a severe drug and alcohol addiction. I was broken, I was suicidal, and I was hopeless. I was at a place in my life where I honestly had given up because I spent years trying to get clean and sober. But little did I know what was in store for me behind the walls which hung that red shield. As I began to navigate this uncharted territory called sobriety, I could feel the presence of something greater than me at work. And over time, my optimism for recovery started to transform into a living hope. Thanks to the alumni and the officers of the program, I started to feel as if I belonged somewhere. I started to feel loved. And most importantly, I started to see the possibility of becoming a new person. And by the time I graduated, I knew without a doubt that God had something big in store for me. But what could God do with someone like me? A junkie, a convict, a basket case. By the grace of God and the love and the support of the Salvation Army, my life slowly started to change. I came to a point in my life where I knew without a doubt that God was real. So I started seeking God, looking for him, and praying for him to help me. I finally came face to face with Jesus, and I decided to entrust my life to him and him alone. My friends, I'm here today as a testimony of the living God. Since January 4, 2012, God has given me a life beyond my wildest dreams. I've traveled the country and been halfway around the world to share the love of Christ. God has also reunited me with the family that I once destroyed. I even met a beautiful woman along the way whom today I call my wife. And over time, God placed a unique calling upon my life. And currently, I am a cadet at the Evangeline Booth College in the USA Southern Territory. God has saved me. God is continuing to restore me. And God has called me to be an officer in the Salvation Army. But above all else, God has filled the hole in my heart. God has given me the boundless riches of salvation and the true joy of living once again. My life verse is James 1:12, which says, "Blessed is the one who perseveres when under trial, because having stood the test of time, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him." God indeed has given me a crown of life, one for eternity and one for now. And I wish to leave you all encouraged to know that William Booth's vision of saving the least, the lost, and the last is alive and well, 150 years strong. Praise be to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Teaches me to kneel again and pray. Over the past year, right around our Army world, there has been a wave of prayer rolling over from one country to another in nonstop, simultaneous 24/7. We continue that wave throughout the Congress and together ask that the Lord Jesus Christ will be with us and honored in and through everything. As we embark on a moment of prayer, and just before we listen to the word of God brought by our general, let us sing that beautiful refrain of the song just sung by the International Staff Songsters, written especially for this moment. Please join the songsters as they lead us.
Parce que tu nous as promis d'être avec nous tous les jours jusqu'à la fin du monde. Seigneur, nous te bénissons et nous te rendons gloire pour les 150 années que tu as été avec nous. Mais nous te bénissons et nous te rendons gloire parce que tu as été avec nous dans le passé, mais tu seras aussi avec nous aujourd'hui, demain et éternellement. Et par avance, nous te disons merci pour tout ce que tu vas encore faire. Ce soir, reçois notre reconnaissance et nous te demandons d'ouvrir nos cœurs, d'ouvrir nos yeux spirituels, nos oreilles spirituelles, afin que nous puissions entendre ta parole et répondre à ta parole. Nous te remercions pour toutes choses et nous demandons tout cela au nom de Jésus-Christ. Amen.
Lord, we come humbly before you at this moment, knowing and feeling that your Spirit is here in this place. It is here to minister to us and to bless us and to fill us with overflowing with your love and mercy. Your Spirit has led our Army up to today, and we celebrate 150 years and all that has taken place, and the many lives that have found the Lord and now we look to the future of our Army. Lord, this is your Army. As we move into the future, we need to receive inspiration from you. We need to know that you are with us, and we need to have you filling our lives to overflowing so that we can meet the days ahead. Father, thank you for the people who have been so involved in the preparation of these days, people who have leaned heavily on your inspiration and your guidance, those who began planning this event even as long as 3 years ago, and for all the participants who have given hours of time in rehearsals. Inspire them and use them to inspire us. Father, we thank you for our leaders, General Andre Cox and Commissioner Sylvia Cox, leaders who love you dearly, leaders who love your people, and we are your people, leaders who desire to serve you faithfully. Bless them and use them to speak your words, your messages to us. We thank you, Lord, for all who are here and for their safe arrivals and for the opportunity that we have had to already meet and greet old friends and to make new. May we continually be conscious of the Christian bond that binds us together. Father, thank you for your boundless love, for your boundless mercy, for your boundless grace that has been available to us daily and the inspiration given us to follow you and to live for you in this world. As we continue on in tonight's program, Lord, we pray that everything will be a blessing and it will praise you. And we make this prayer in the matchless name of Jesus.
And before the channel come to bring the word of God, let us read in the Bible from Matthew 24, verse 39 to 42. This is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field. One will be taken, and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken, and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. May God bless his word. Amen.
I'm all right. I'm okay.
Well, what a privilege it is for us to be able to celebrate what God has accomplished through the lives of so many people during these past 150 years. This is not a celebration about the Salvation Army. It's a celebration about what God has done in and through the ordinary lives of people like you and like me. We don't come to worship the name Salvation Army. We come to worship the one who is worthy. We come to worship God, who alone is worthy of our praise as we gather here in these days. And we want to celebrate that fact. More importantly, we want to pause and reflect on what God is calling us to do. What God is calling us to do in our lives, in our homes, in our families, in the communities in which we serve. There is a great danger for us in this generation that we can become a settled people, a satisfied people, well content with the achievements of the past. A people well contented with our lives of relative ease and material wealth. A self-centered people. William Booth is reported to have said, when considering the greatest dangers facing the church, he said this: I consider that the chief dangers which confront the coming century will be religion without the Holy Ghost, Christianity without Christ, forgiveness without repentance, salvation without regeneration, politics without God, and heaven without hell. He was speaking about the challenges that he saw facing the 20th century. And you know what? If William Booth came back tonight, he'd still say the same thing. The world in which we live is a battlefield. And in this battlefield, we need soldiers to be mobilized, to be ready to fight for what is right. God hates sin. And you can be sure he doesn't like what he sees in our world today. So much injustice. So much sin. The early day salvationists were truly filled by the power of the Holy Spirit, and they went out to win the world for Jesus. No danger, no sacrifice,
No difficulty seemed to daunt them. They were on a mission to change the world for Jesus. My friends, as we are in this 21st century, I ask myself, well, what has knocked the stuffing out of us? What has knocked the stuffing out of this generation? Was the expectation of our forebears wrong? Was it over-optimistic? Was it unrealistic? No, Jesus said in the Great Commission, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of the nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And get this, my friends, Jesus said it, and surely I am with you. Someone's got the message. I am with you until the very end of the age. Well, of course, the world has seen some terrible things since the time of William Booth. There have been wars on a scale that we could never have imagined. Economic crises that have shaken the very foundations of our society. And as a result, there's been a huge swing away from religion and the things of God. People everywhere seem to have lost confidence now in just about everything. It's no longer politically correct in our world to stand for anything, to maintain any firm beliefs. We live in an increasing materialistic and secular world, and perhaps lament rather more than we should that Christians and Christianity seem to be relegated to the periphery of society. In the brokenness, in the uncertainty of our world, we realize that despite all the advancement of knowledge, despite the advancement of technology, that we're far from the ideal of the kingdom of God as we see it in Scripture. But my friends, we cannot sit back comfortably in our seats this evening, because this is a battle that calls for total mobilization. We are engaged in an epic battle in which people's lives are at risk. And the great danger we face is that we ourselves become attracted and listen to the voices of the world. The danger is that our hearts become more inclined to the material rewards of this life. My friends, let us not sell our souls at a cheap price, because they were won at great cost. These are dangerous and challenging times. And sometimes we live in this world as though it will never end, but the Bible tells us that Jesus is coming again. Jesus will return. He will come and He will establish God's reign and God's kingdom in all its fullness. But Jesus makes no bones in telling His disciples these are going to be tough and difficult times. But He reminds His disciples, don't lose focus. Don't fall asleep. Don't become complacent. Don't become deceived by what you see and what you hear in this world. There are voices in this world that invite us now to write our own theology. They whisper that there are many ways in which we can become saved. So many people now interpret Scripture to suit their personal leanings and desires that I bet you it will not be long before we see tailor-made Scriptures to justify any of our shortcomings. We live in a world where it's no longer politically correct to state that the Bible is the Word of God, that the Bible is the unquestionable authority for Christian living. We seem to live in a world that has no recognition, gives no recognition to the fact that, as the Scripture said, all have sinned and fall far short of the glory of God. We need a Savior. Praise God, we have a Savior. When we follow the leanings of our hearts, when we rely on our own conscience, we can be led astray. And therefore, the Bible is and always will remain the bedrock, the moral compass for our lives. My friends, you need to read it and read it regularly. Well, I guess William and Catherine Booth could hardly have realized what turmoil, what anguish, what pain, what death and misery would visit and dominate the greater part of the 20th century and well into this 21st century. And despite the fact that many were trumpeting at the turn of the century that we would see a new world order and a much fairer society, it seems in some respects that things have got worse. But my friends, if we are insecure in our faith, if we are afraid to witness for Christ in this world, how will people know of God's plan of salvation? The disciples, therefore, are reminded by Jesus that as we wait for his coming, we are to be faithful, we are to be diligent. Yes, we are to remain faithful amidst the tribulations and the trials. There are going to be times when we need to dig deep, because only those who endure will win the prize. Increasingly, we see in our world that following Christ comes at great cost. Christians all over the world are being persecuted in different ways. What is happening in the Middle East is of great concern, where Christian communities who have been there for centuries are being wiped out, persecuted, killed. No, my friends, this isn't for the faint-hearted. For if our faith in God is not strong, we simply will not be able to stand against the challenges and the tribulations to come. And we can't rely on our past history and some of the great things that have been accomplished in Christ's name around the world. We are called in this generation to be building, to build God's kingdom. We're a people to be a people with our sleeves rolled up. We are to be this generation writing the pages of history for those who will come after us. Our task has not changed. It remains the same. We need to be actively involved in spreading the gospel message around the world. And Jesus in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, was saying to his disciples, my friends, you need to be ready. You need to be ready for my return at all times. The date of the return of Christ is known only to God the Father. We're not to speculate, but we are to be ready. The Bible warns us of the imminence of Christ's return, and we're called to be about our duty, ready for whenever he returns. Well, what should we look like if we are a people who are mobilized and ready? Well, I've shared something of what I think it looks like in that dream that we saw at the beginning of this meeting. And this is what I think it should look like if we are to be a people who are ready, a people who are mobilized. I dream of a committed, effective, and joyful army, rooted and confident in the Word of God, but on its knees. I believe we need to recapture the fire and the zeal of our ancestors if we are to make a difference in this world and in this generation. If we are truly salt and light in this world, it means that we should be a positive influence. And we can be used by God. We can be used by God to bring about change and transformation. But I ask myself the question, what real difference are we making? Jesus never promised that our journey through life would be trouble-free. Our faith does not shield us from the harshness, the struggle, the difficulties of life. But Jesus promised, I will be with you I will be with you, said Jesus. Do you believe it? Is that your personal testimony? Is that your experience? As we gather in these days and as we worship, we should be a thankful people. We're not drifters in this world. God has planned the future. He is in control of our destiny. And we know that there will be a climax in human history when Jesus will return. But everything that we do must work towards that day. Our social service, our compassion, our response in times of disaster only has meaning as we seek to hasten the day of Christ's return by preaching the gospel message to the world. We must be willing in this world to share in Christ's sufferings. We bear the name of our Master. We bear his name in a world that has largely rejected him. But we're called to be vigilant, watchful, living our lives. Living our lives in the here and now, but also in the light of the future to come. We're to live in confidence, no matter how badly it seems that the very foundations of our world are being shaken. Jesus said as he was leaving, and surely I am with you always to the very end. Do we trust him? Do we listen to him? Do we follow him? Then we will remain rooted and confident. No wonder we can be a joyful army, my friends. If, however, we're to effectively reach the world for Jesus in this generation, then I believe we need to experience once again the power and the presence of God moving in our hearts and in our lives. We need to experience his change and transformation. We need to be a people who are confident and rooted in the Word of God. A people who believe that the Word of God is the true lamp to light our way. And we need, more importantly, to live our lives in total surrender to God's call, to God's will for each one of us. We celebrate what God has done in and through people like you and me over these past 150 years. But God is calling us forward. God is calling us to write the pages of history going forward from this moment, from right now. Will your life count? Will it make a difference in the world? It can and will if we allow God to guide us, to mold us, to shape us, to equip us to be witnesses to the present generation. Well, I don't know your situations and all of the places from where you have come to be here in London in these days. I do know that none of you have come here by chance. God has called you. God is calling you to this place, to be in his presence, to listen to what he is saying to you. God is present with us now. And God will be present with us in the future. I don't know what your needs are, but I know the one who can meet your need this evening. The world may look an unsafe place. The world may be rocked by war, by natural disasters, by economic meltdown, by pain, by suffering. But God hasn't changed through the ages. His message of love to the world has not changed. His plan of salvation for humanity remains unchanged. If we want security in the future, my friends, it can only be found in God. It can only be found as we listen to his word, as we yield to his will, as we surrender our lives to him. Well, perhaps as we come to the concluding moments of our meeting this evening, there are those here in our midst that need to make that response, perhaps here on this very first meeting, this very first meeting of our Boundless Congress. Well, this is a huge arena. It's not the most practical place for a Salvation Army meeting or a response to the mercy seat, but we have here a cross. And there are some of you seated in this area and in the lower tiers who perhaps can have access and to come and to kneel at this altar, but it doesn't really matter. This whole arena becomes a mercy seat as we are in the presence of the Lord. And I'm going to ask these staff songsters, please, to sing for us just quietly as I conclude these moments or this segment of our meeting this evening. Your grace still amazes me. And as they sing, open your heart and be amazed at God's grace. And perhaps God's grace is calling you. When you think of what God has done for you, what God has accomplished in your lives, perhaps as the songsters come, you need to come and to kneel in dedication. But I do ask that only those in the lower tiers and those who can see a clear way to come, come. It will be impractical, I know, for many of you, but you can kneel where you are, you can stand where you are, you can pray with someone where you are. But just as the songsters come, this is your moment. If you wish to respond to the Lord this evening, then do so as they sing.
Your grace still amazes me.
Spirit of prayer, I'd like to remind you that in each of your bags you received a commitment card. And if God is speaking to you in these days, whether it's this evening or whether it'll be in other meetings, take the time to fill in this card. Share with us what God is speaking to your heart so that we can join with you in rejoicing because God's grace is so real for us this evening. And so we continue in an attitude of prayer, but I invite you to continue to respond in your hearts. And as we listen to the band playing, the opportunity is still given if you want to come, and if you're able to come from where you're sitting, to come and to kneel at this cross.
Thank you.
thank you this evening for your presence, for your great grace for each one of us. We thank you because you have called us, because you equip us. And Father, we are blessed to be in your presence, and we sense the moving of your Spirit, and we pray your blessing upon each one of us, but we pray for those who are seeking you just now. You know each one of them. You know all about them. You want to lead them, you want to guide them, you want to bless them. Father, we pray that you will empower them, that you will equip them. Father, we need you. Help us to be the people you want us to be for the glory of your name. For we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And as transmission leads us in a time of worship, there are people still praying. And so let us join with them as we continue in our worship this evening.
Christ for the world we sing, the world to Christ we bring, all of its suffering untold. Every tribe and tongue into the strong arms of God. Christ for Christ for the world we see.
All of his son.
to Christ we bring all of his suffering unsold. Every tribe and tongue to the strong arms of God. Christ for the world, Christ for the world we sing. Can we sing it one more time together? Lift your voices. Oh, Christ for the world, we sing. The world to Christ, we bring all of its suffering unsold. Every tribe and song to the strong.
Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. And with those strong words of Charles Wesley, we conclude this evening of celebration and inspiration. And we're going to sing those words. The International Staff Band will lead us, and we will follow and sing the words, which will be on the screen in front of us.
Thank you.
Now, the benediction.
I request that you remain standing as we pronounce the benediction in Kiswahili. Bwana mwenyewe ambaye ndiye chanzo cha amani, awajalie amani siku zote kwa kila namna Bwana awe nanyi nyote. Mungu mwenyewe aliyetupatia amani, awatakase nyinyi kabisa kwa kila namna na kujilinda nafsi zenu, roho zenu, mioyo na miili yenu. Kwake yeye awezaye kuwalinda msije mkaanguka na kuwaleta nyinyi bila hatia mpaka mbele ya utukufu wake, kwake yeye aliye peke yake Mungu, mkombozi wetu, uwe utukufu, ukuu, nguvu na mamlaka kwa njia ya Kristo Bwana wetu, tangu sasa na hata milele, and the old people will say amen. 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 Thank you.
Now, we just finished this amazing meeting, the first meeting that kicked off the 150-year birthday celebrations on Founders Day, a joyful army. Yeah. What are your reflections, guys? What's going on?
A child flew. None child. Of you saw it. There was no, a child flying. I loved it. Right at the beginning, the big opening and the kids with the all the shapes from the Boundless logo and a child flew.
I missed that.
Wow. Like, totally. I know that.
There was one child. Person in the entire stadium
that
saw a child fly.
Somebody text in and say, did the child fly?
Yeah, look, yes.
Where is the child?
If, if anybody else saw the child, could you text Boundless Live, hashtag Boundless Live, and say, I saw that child too, because we're a bit worried about Boundless.
I'm sure
there was. I'm sure there was a flying child. flying child. If not, there should have been.
There should have been. That's a new part of the New Testament, which hasn't been discovered yet. Yeah, the flying child.
It was
fantastic.
Well, I don't know about you guys, but for me, one of the most amazing parts of the meeting, I'm still kind of working through it, are the testimonies.
They featured these three incredible
testimonies. Whoa. Using sort of the symbolisms of the colors of the Salvation Army as sort of symbols of what God was doing in real people's lives. I found that to be absolutely amazing.
I think that the girl that spoke, you know, Melanie, Melanie's testimony, yeah.
Well, she was fantastic. She comes from where I was born, actually, in Haiti. So we obviously had a real resonance.
Sure.
But I absolutely loved her story. This idea, this journey of saying, I live in this kind of nihilistic place where I don't have meaning, I don't have purpose, I try this, I try that, I don't have any answers. And then she meets Jesus. Right. Then she has this conversation. But the doorway to that was this welcoming community of people saying, you're included.
Yeah,
you don't believe the same as us. You don't act the same as us. You don't dress the same as us. But you're included anyway.
Right.
That's what we're about.
You belong.
I love that bit where she said, I sneaked in on the back row.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I sat on the back row. And then she sort of went a few, you know what I mean? And then, and guess what? And now I'm on the front row as if, you know what? I've committed. Yeah. And I've taken the next step and I've accepted God into my life. And then she's serving. I think she said she's doing the youth program or something.
Yeah.
She's involved in Sunday school.
You know what's challenging to me about that testimony was not only just her story of God impacting her life and Jesus saving her and filling the spots inside of her that were empty, but also the fact that the witness to her was people who didn't give up.
Sure.
You know, people who weren't tired of doing that over and over. And I think in some ways the Congress is about the people who, you know, and you might even be watching this right now in the post show and you weren't here, so you thought you couldn't respond to the message of Jesus, but you certainly can, even where you are right now. We want you to know that Jesus is still in the business of saving lives and he can save your life. But also I just thought what an encouragement it was to me as somebody who was trying to love people over and over and over again and be inclusive and do it again and risk it again and take the, you know, heartbreak again and keep on going. And what encouragement it was that was the impacting thing, was that God's people doing that.
It was a normal midweek church, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't the big Sunday, it wasn't the big celebration, as great as that is. It was sitting on the primary chairs and just with all the mess around them, and this woman just comes to faith. I love that.
I think the amazing thing out of the other two testimonies too was it was an incredible indication that Jesus still changes lives.
Yeah.
So these are broken lives, these are lives completely messed up, and Jesus just breaks in and changes their lives.
Yes.
I thought it was amazing.
I think Chris was the other person. Absolutely. The last testimony was that Chris who basically crawled, I crawled to the doors of the ARC in Philadelphia, and now he stood there giving his life for full-time ministry.
Yeah. You want him for your officer, don't you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
You can imagine him preaching.
That man's going to preach. But the lady who now works in Kenya, a lady from India, I was sitting there thinking about the courage it took for her to say, actually, despite my family's background, this whole Hindu thing, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow that kind of pantheon of gods. I'm going to follow Jesus. Because he showed me he's the way, the truth, and life. And then said, that was a fantastic thing. I'm not going to be shunned by my family. I'm going to go after my family.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So that they might know him as well.
That was really
inspiring. And Melanie was living another faith as well, wasn't she?
Yeah.
She was strongly influenced by Buddhism.
Buddhism, she said.
And
yeah.
so these are folk that are saying, actually, this is the strongholds that we're living under, and we're pulling away from that.
I thought the faith of the officer there too as well, to say, you know, your baby's dying and there's nothing to be done. But there's a God that we have who can do impossible things, and we can ask him, why not try?
Yeah.
And I thought, you know, those moments sometimes where we're shy to sort of press into that, and we're just kind of like, oh, will he show up, will he not show up? And we can just, again, renew our faith that God's real, that he's working in our lives, that he can actually do impossible things. It was a beautiful reminder.
I think the other thing, too, that was powerful with her testimony was there's that incredible reminder that there are soldiers right across the world that are just playing the game.
Right, sure.
In uniform, been doing it for years, but actually don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ.
Right, because she became a soldier to please her husband. That's
absolutely.
What she, yeah, that was
And she was a soldier powerful. That was crying out to other gods.
Right.
When her son was ill. And so I think it's a powerful reminder to us, but also to soldiers, get real.
Yes.
You know, don't play the game, because when
God.
You get real, you actually see Jesus break in and do amazing things, miracles.
Yes. I was quite distracted near the beginning, because there was this the moment where the commentator said, you know, all of these people are coming in all the different flags.
That was great. That was really moving, actually.
He said, would you welcome all the representatives of the world for whom Jesus died? And my brain said, fantastic. And then my brain said, but what about all those flags that aren't here?
Right.
Well, that all of those nations that still yet don't know Jesus
right.
haven't even had the opportunity to know Jesus and have all sorts of barriers in their way to get to know Jesus.
Right.
And if the Salvation Army is here to do anything, it's here to reach those people. That's what we're about. Reaching
absolutely.
The people that can't normally be reached by the church. Yeah. That's what we should do.
I think it was the general that made that great saying. He said, we want to light a fire around the world. That's the thing that I was exactly following on from
absolutely.
What you said there, Phil.
Yeah.
That's what we need to do.
I also thought it was a really important thing that it was said several times that we're not here to kind of worship even the traditionalism or the past of the Salvation Army or our founders or anything like that. There's only one person worthy of worship, and it's Jesus. And we're going to give worship to Jesus alone. And I thought, you know, I just think that's really important to keep saying, you know, and reminding ourselves that actually this whole thing is about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And if it's not bringing glory to Jesus, then it's not what we're supposed to be about.
Well, events such as this could easily become idolatrous.
Absolutely.
And I think tonight the emphasis very clearly, as you've said, was on Jesus. And I think the general made that point.
He made that exact point. Again, I wrote that down. We haven't come to worship the Salvation Army. We've come to worship God. That's what General Andre Cox said. And he made that very clear in everything that he said tonight.
And all the cool stuff at the beginning, whether it was the Old Testament picture or the New Testament picture, is about actually you've got a job to do. Was about actually I'm sending you, you're called to be out there and make a difference, to be the light. That's what I read from
there. When he was making that call towards the end, he said, hey guys, he said, I want an army that is grounded in the word but on its knees. Call to prayer, that actually guys, it's not us that does it, but it's only the power and the strength of Jesus that can actually change the world.
Powerful.
We've spoken a lot about all of those things, which is great. We're going to come back and talk a little bit later. But we've also got a few little highlights that we want to look at. So, guys, if you're still watching us, that's great. Let's see some highlights from tonight.
We've been having an awesome time with our friends, having a little reflection about the meeting and all that kind of stuff, and you've been part of that. We're excited that you've been a part of that discussion. But also, we invited these folks not just to discuss the meeting, but also because they embody a Salvation Army spirit, and they have an impact that goes around the world, and we wanted to give them a chance. You know, I just was thinking, if you had 30 seconds, which is actually what you have on the show, if you had 30 seconds and you could just say like a vision casting statement, like just something you wanted to encourage Salvationists around the world and who are here at the Congress, you know, what would you say? Let's start with Brendan Noddle, all the way from Australia.
Thank you.
30
you.
Seconds of spiritual pump.
Look, I think when the Salvation Army was raised up by God, he called the Salvation Army out of the institutionalized church. And he called the Salvation Army to be an army of people that would go into the dark places in Jesus' name, empowered by his spirit, to actually transmute the lives and the communities that they, the Salvationists went into. Transmute means completely change the form of. Now, are we being called back into the church today? Absolutely not. God is calling the Salvation Army out of the buildings and back into the dark places, back to the very places he called us to be in 1865.
Right. Yeah. Wow. I love that. See what I mean? That's awesome. We agree.
Another long word, Phil.
Yeah, no, I've got a long word.
Phil Wall?
Well, I think whenever we have these heritage moments, I'm often challenged to think, like we were at the beginning, about the book of Isaiah, and particularly Isaiah chapter 51, verse 1, where Isaiah says to the nation of Israel, he says, would you go back to the rock from which you were cut and the quarry from which you are hewn? Go back from the rock between your cut and the quarry from which you are hewn. And I think these things are always about not looking back for sentimentality's sake, but looking back for inspiration, that DNA at the heart of who we are as an organisation, to go into those places, Brendan says, where it's hardest to connect with people, where it's hardest to reach people with the message of Jesus. I also have this thing that's came to mind a few years ago that William and Catherine Booth, they prayed so many prayers to God. And so all of the unanswered prayers that still are yet to be answered, on all the promises that God made to them, they're ours, they're our inheritance. Right. They belong to this generation and those to come. And we need to take hold of that and give ourselves to it fully.
Yeah, right on.
Cheers. Easy for me, because I think we should transmute. I think we should go back to the rock. I think we need to do what William Catherine did at the beginning and make a difference in the way we are today. All the programs, all the things that are working and making a difference are happening just because people are taking a step of faith and doing those things that made a difference.
Absolutely.
All the really structural stuff, the raising the age of consent and the match factory stuff, all that was then, and now it's happening. People are doing new things, and the difference you make is being the person you're supposed to be, because I'm not as full on as those guys. Just break out of being the person you think you should be and be the person God wants you to be. Sure. Be boundless, unrestricted, especially if you're at home watching. Don't be jealous of us here. This is great. This is just the party, but it's actually about an intentional relationship with Jesus, which makes you the person that God calls you to be.
That's right.
Transmuted.
That's our key word for today, transmuted.
We've
all learned a new word.
Never.
Has anybody actually checked to see if that word exists?
No. Never.
Let's just go with it.
How are you spelling that?
Yeah, I don't want to talk about this personal commitment card. If you've been in the arena this evening, you'll have got one of these in your welcome pack. You can also get them online. This is to say that tonight you made a commitment, maybe renewed a commitment to God, to say, you know what, I want to be one of those people that step forward. I want to be one of those people who step back and do something different for you right now. I don't want to be the person that just stands there having been in uniform for 20, 30 years, but I want to be someone who's a real Christian, doing real cutting-edge work for you. This is what this card's about. You can have a look. It's online. It's SA My Response Card. It would be great if you could fill this in, because this will go back to your territory, it will go back through to your division, and it will go back to your course, so someone can contact you and can talk to you about that. We've had a great, the great first day. I cannot believe we're still on the first day at Congress, and we've still got 3-4 full days to go. And SA Today, who do an amazing job, have put together a package of really the news of what's been going on around Congress. So let's take a look.
The International Music Festival took place last night, including several different army band and songster groups.
There's a lot of talk in the church and within the Salvation Army about what we sing and what we play and the relevance of music, and those discussions are valid. But clearly in the Salvation Army, we have a remarkable heritage of music. And I think it's important that we don't lose sight of this wonderful input of music that is available to us, some of which stands the test of time.
The Boundless Trade Shop is open and located within the O2 Arena and full of resources for Salvationists and friends visiting the Congress, including the new songbook.
We're so pleased at SP&S that we can sell the new Salvation Army songbook for $13.95 in the Super Trade store here at Boundless Congress. we understand that this book has been so long in preparation, and it's so exciting that it's just been released in time for all the Salvationists from all over the world. We understand this is such an important resource, and we're really pleased to sell it in our shop.
Salvation Army volunteers were at Heathrow Airport, welcoming delegates as they arrive.
It's very exciting here today at Heathrow because we're meeting all the sponsored delegates from the other countries. So we're rather busy. We've had people from Haiti and India and the Bahamas and Madrid, and they're all arriving on their flights and we're greeting them.
The Boundless Theatre is just one part of the Boundless experience at the O2. This venue will house concerts, a daily international prayer meeting, and other important events. Check out boundless2015.org under the Boundless Experience for a full listing of events. As we close, we look at the second verse of the Founder's Song. My sins, they are many, their stains are so deep, and bitter the tears of remorse that I weep. But useless is weeping. Thou great crimson sea, thy waters can cleanse me. Come roll over me. For Salvation Army Today, I'm Chris Raymer. God bless.
Where are you from?
We're from Canada, and it's Canada Day, so happy Canada Day.
Hey, welcome back to Savin' TV and the post show. We've been having an awesome time together, transmuting awesome. The world, talking about it, and all kinds of things, visioning for a new day. We're going to be back tomorrow, and tomorrow's theme is going to be a unified army, which is going to be incredible to talk about, and we've got some great stuff planned.
Yep, tomorrow is Founders Day.
Right.
Yeah, Thursday, awesome. second of July is Founders Day. So that's going to be a really cool day tomorrow. Make sure you tune in. If you can't be here in person, tune in, watch it online. The pre-show starts at 9 a.m. tomorrow. So please, boundlesslive.com, make sure you tune in. Very special guest tomorrow. We have great guy, and we're coming in with his wife, Commissioner Kay, but also General Raider is coming in. Superb guy.
Good people.
He's coming in to speak to us in the morning, but he's also going to do something very special. He's going to be launching his very latest book. And we're going to ask him if we can have a copy, ask him to sign it and see if we can give it away as a prize tomorrow. So that's our competition tomorrow. I'm sucking my neck out now because I've said he's going to sign a book for us. So let's hope that he will sign a book for us tomorrow. But he's going to launch it, tell us all about it, tell us about his missionary work and about his life as a Salvation Army officer and then, of course, leader of the International Salvation Army. The Hong Kong Praise Dancers are coming to the studio. And we also have Robin Briggio. He's going to be coming in to have a chat with us about being a social media soldier, which is a great brand new ministry headed up through Savin' TV, which is really the new social media hub of everything that is going on with the Salvation Army. It's the virtual street corner. It is our way to evangelize around the world since we don't do quite as many open airs anymore. This is a new way. So please come back with us tomorrow. From all our guests, we all say good night.
Bye-bye.
God bless and join us tomorrow.
Stay transmuted.